morning. Welcome to Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. My name is Erin. Before we get started, we'd like to fill you in on some things that are happening here at MGBC for you and for your family. If you have a child that becomes restless, we have a live feed of the service in our family room located near the entrance to the children's wing. Tonight is our night of prayer for first responders. None of us hope that we need a police, fire, or medical emergency response. But if we do, we are certainly thankful for those men and women that come to assist. Sometimes these professionals put their lives on the line for us. Tonight at 6:30 p.m., we will join together at the Martinsburg Fire Hall to lift our hearts in prayer for these men and women as they serve our community. The 2020 budget proposal for MGBC is now available. You can stop by the Information Center and pick up your copy. If you have questions prior to the membership vote on Sunday, February 2nd, please contact Shirley Stoltz.
On Sunday, February 2nd, we'll be having our Super Bowl fundraiser directly after the worship service. In your ABF classes, there are sign-ups of what you can do to contribute. Also at the meal, we'll be taking donations that will be given to our students to help them to attend youth-sponsored trips that we take. I know, for instance, a couple of summers ago, a few of our students felt the call of God to pursue ministry as a vocation. That event was able to take place because of your donation to them to attend such an event. So please know that when you are supporting our students through their fundraisers, you are also supporting them in pursuing God's best for them. Cell groups will be taking place. Junior high will be 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock at Phil and Becky Cope's, and senior high will be 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock at Mike and Leslie Williams. Last cell group, one of our junior high students threw hay at me, and you know who you are, and yes, I'm still removing hay from that jacket. Also at senior high cell group, I had a dog that barked at me repeatedly, but at the end of the day, I believe that dog became my friend. Also at both groups, we talked about connecting with God in a meaningful way in 2020.
Thanks for joining us this morning. If you missed the announcements or would like more info, visit us at mgbconline.com.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. If you stayed home and you're watching this on the internet, you did the right thing. But welcome to you as well, and as well as anybody who might be in the overflow room. Would you stand with me and read the call to worship, Psalm 150, 3-6. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud flashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. And we come here this morning to praise you, as these verses say. Regardless of we might find ourselves in today, we're here to praise you because of what you've done for us through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We thank you that we have access, easy access to you, that whenever you died on the cross, the veil was torn, and that we have all that we need to do to have access to you is accept you as our Savior. And in the Bible, when you went and you called your disciples, you didn't give them a list of things to do and tell them that they had to do a bunch of things to come to you. You just said, follow me. And so for us in our lives as well, we pray for the same thing, that Lord, that we would be obedient to your call in our lives. And we thank you that we don't have to do a lot of things to get cleaned up to come to you. We just need to believe in you and accept you as our Savior. We pray for this service this morning as we sing these songs, Lord, that we would praise you through the songs. And as Daryl preaches, Lord, that you would convict us of sin in our lives, and Lord, that we would do what you tell us to do. We pray this all in your name. Amen.
As we sing, we're declaring the truth of God's word, and we're putting our prayers to melody. And I love this prayer to melody in particular in verse 4 of the song that we're going to sing that says, "My heart, my life, my all I bring to Christ who loves me so. He is my master, Lord, and King. Wherever he leads, I'll go." Let's let this be the prayer of our hearts this morning, whether we're worshiping in the worship center or if we're at home on the live stream. Let's really let these words from this hymn sink into our hearts and let it be our prayer. Please join us in singing.
Take up my cross and follow me. I heard my master say, I gave my life to ransom thee. Surrender your all today. Wherever he leads, I'll go. Wherever he leads, I'll go.
Well, it's good to see you up here, Jerry. You had the elementary school retreat this weekend, and you're rested and energized. I heard great things about it.
We had a great time. We were over at the Shalp Lodge just across the mountain, and we had about 8-9 families that came to the first ever family retreat, and it was a lot of fun. We even got some sled riding in, and everyone made it safely back over the mountain in the ice yesterday. So, yeah, it was really fun. We had
terrific.
A great time.
Thank you for you and Aaron for your work with that. Appreciate it.
We want to tell you about a big, exciting change that's coming to our preschoolers. Starting on February 2nd, we're going to be welcoming our preschool kids here into worship just like the elementary kids do. So they're going to follow the exact same schedule that our elementary kids follow. So parents of preschoolers, make sure you take a listen to this. And the rest of you, I think this is important for you to hear, which is why I'm up here this morning so all of you can know this. We want our preschoolers to be here for a couple of reasons. First of all, they are back in the nursery for 3.5 hours on a Sunday morning. That's a really long time for them to be in one room. And our preschoolers are totally capable of worshiping with us. They're capable of seeing and hearing what it is that we're doing. And so I think it's important for them to see and to participate and to be a part of the church family. I think it's also really important for our preschoolers to know that church is more than just what happens in the nursery. Most of them come in the door, walk straight through the lobby and straight back to the nursery wing, and they never ever are in this sanctuary with us. And so I think it's really important for our preschoolers to be here with our church family and understand what it means to come to Big Church, understand what it means to be with all of you as a church family. I also think it's really important for them to start to experience worship. In the preschool room, it's a little different. You sing with a video on a TV. It's a very different experience singing with our whole church family and the praise band and understanding what that really means to worship God. And so we think our 3- and 4-year-olds are totally capable of that. So starting February 2nd, the schedule will look slightly different, and we'll talk a little bit more about details. Parents, you'll be getting a letter with some more information. But just know that our preschoolers will start to be here. As a church family, your job is to welcome them and to appreciate that they're here and to tolerate a little bit more noise and rowdiness and a little bit more wiggles and be okay with that, because we want them to be here and we want them to feel like they're a part of our family. So 2 weeks and we'll start to have little ones here.
I'm excited for that. I don't know about you guys. I love like VBS, the 3- and 4-year-olds are with us, and they are some of the best singers we have. So I think that's gonna be awesome. Maybe we can get them up front. I don't know. That's always fun. That's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm here to talk about our Forge and Refine ministries. If you're not familiar with those, Forge is for men, Refine's for women. And they're discipleship tools that we just launched this past fall that challenge us in spiritual growth, relational growth, some physical growth. And they're built around small group accountability partnerships. So we concluded our first kind of trial run of that this past fall. We finished up a little bit after Thanksgiving. And just a heads up, if you participated and you got one of the incentives, a t-shirt or a water bottle, they are available out in front of Aaron's office, in front of the main church entrance office, that way. Just if you're lost, ask an usher, they'll help you find it. But there's a table with t-shirts and bottles with your names on it, so if you got one of those, please pick that up. We're planning to launch another round here at the end of February, so we're about a month and a half out from that. And we really want to get feedback from people that participated the first time. Nothing's set in stone with what we're doing. We really want to get feedback from people that did it. That way we can make it better and make it more applicable or, I guess, more accessible to a wider group of people in the church. So if you did it the first time around and didn't give us any feedback yet, that same website where all of our challenges were is still active. You can go on there and go to our feedback page and get us some info as to how you thought it went. Give us the good, the bad, the ugly. I can handle it. Or I can go to Pastor Brian when I'm upset. It's fine. So please do that. Like I said, we're planning to launch our next round at the end of February. So whether you joined us the first time or not, we'd love for you to prayerfully consider joining us for the next time around. Maybe you'd like to go through it with the same group. Maybe you really started to connect with the people that you participated with the first time. Or maybe after going through it the first time, God's really put somebody on your heart that you want to disciple and start spending some time with. Either way, it's fine. Or if you're new and never did it before and want to sign up with a new group, you're welcome to do that. We'll get some more info out in the next couple of weeks as far as registration and some of the info and the timing. And if you want a little bit of a taste of what it is, so say you didn't do it the first time and you're just really curious what it looks like, if you go to the church website, mgbconline.com, click on discipleship, you'll see all the stuff from the first round, and it'll be formatted similarly. How do you say that word?
Similarly.
More similar to the last time.
It'll be a lot like the last time.
It'll be a lot like the last time with some tweaks, hopefully, from our congregation. That's all I got.
Terrific. Thanks, Ryan. Appreciate your work with that. Other bulletin announcements. We're not going to spend a whole lot of time, but please check the bulletin, especially men's ministry. There's a breakfast coming up, and today's the last day to sign up for that, as well as there's a trip going to the outdoor show on February the 8th, and so you can find all that information in your bulletin, and you can register online, go to one of the kiosks, or use your phone, or through your ABF class at the information desk as well. Gentlemen, as you come this morning to take our tithes and offerings, we want to pray for Pastor Larry Graybill, as he was hospitalized yesterday. Pastor Graybill is the father of Emily Yates, and many of you know Emily Yates. Also for my Aunt Dorothy McCall in California. She is currently in hospice care. Dorothy's maiden name was Longenecker, so she's associated with the Longenecker family here as well. And finally, Brad and Amber Howells, they've been here for the past several weeks. They will be heading back to Zambia to minister there. They are the son and daughter and son-in-law of Ken and Sandy Rice, and they'll be returning to the field. And so we want to lift them up in prayer this morning. So would you join me, please? Father, we thank you and praise you for your love. We thank you for how you bless. We would ask that you would be with Pastor Graybill and the Yates family and the other family that is connected in this situation. I just pray that you'll move with power and strength for the doctors and for Dorothy McCall in California. Provide peace and comfort as she looks to the day in which she will soon be with you, Father. And so we just ask that you would just bless them and provide them with encouragement during a difficult time. We pray for all of our missionaries, but in particular, Brad and Amber, as they will be going back to Zambia with their family. May their ministry be fruitful. May they sense your spirit. May they just be able to connect with the people of that region across cultural lines. And we just thank you and praise you for their willingness to serve you in this capacity. And now, Father, we worship you. Our goal, our mission is to worship God and serve others. And now, Father, we worship you in giving back the tithes and offerings of how you have so graciously blessed us. We give this prayer in the name of your Son.
We worship. Through giving this morning, let's take some time to refocus our hearts on our King, and that's Jesus. So maybe he put somebody on your heart that you want to pray for. Maybe there's something that happened this week that you really need to just surrender to him. Whatever it is, whatever God lays on your heart, take some time, talk to him one-on-one. When the plates make it to the back of the balcony, we'll stand, we'll sing together.
To the world to save, while we were sinners, you forgave. saving mercy you have shown. That your perfect patience might be known. Honor and glory forever and ever we sing. To the immortal, invisible, eternal King. You alone are God of everything.
We pray for those along our path and intercede on their behalf. It's good and pleasing in your view for all to understand your truth.
Oh, honor and glory forever and ever we sing. Immortal, invisible, eternal King. You alone are God of everything. Revealed in the flesh, proven by the Spirit, seen by the angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, taken up in glory.
Again, all honor and glory.
All honor and glory forever and ever we sing. To the immortal, invisible, eternal King.
You alone.
You alone are God of everything.
Sing it one more time. All honor and glory.
All honor and glory forever and ever we sing. To the immortal, invisible, eternal King. You alone are God of everything.
Amen.
worthy is the Lamb.
Is called King of Glory. And before we sing that, I just wanted to read some scripture that is actually titled like King of Glory exactly. And it's found in Psalms 24, 8 through 10. And it just says, "Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of Glory. And another one in Romans 8:18 that says, For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. So whether you're singing this song out of like adoration for our King of Glory, or you're looking forward to the glory to come, may we just all sing this with our whole hearts.
You are my hope.
dear Jesus. May the songs that we've sung today, may that be the true echo of our hearts. May those words like be sung around your throne right now as we join millions and billions of others, brothers and sisters, in worshiping of you right now, that you hear it all. And that's a wonderful thing, and we stand in awe of you. We pray that you would just meet us today, that you would reveal your heart to us and for us through your word as we go through it. We give this prayer in your name. Amen. You may be seated. And children are now dismissed for children's church. So, not gonna lie, it's been a while since I've been up here doing this. So, yeah, it's just been kind of crazy. In fact, I almost forgot I was preaching today. No, this is what I mean. This is what happened. So, I came in here and I did a mic check, and then I had to go teach sixth grade Sunday school, and I'm still having my mic on. And I go in there, and one of the kids, they say, "Why are you wearing that mic?" And I said, "Because I'm preaching." And they didn't say this outwardly, but looking in their eyes, it was like, "Well, that looks stupid." And I began thinking, it does look stupid. Why am I wearing this mic? I'm not preaching for another hour. So then I took the mic off, and I put it like on a cabinet, and we did Sunday school. And then I realized I had like chocolate milk I left in the class. So I went upstairs, grabbed the chocolate milk, put it in the fridge, and I realized I didn't have my mic. Kind of lifted upstairs in the sixth grade Sunday school room, and I thought, oh man, I'm glad I remembered that because I was going to preach without a mic. So then service got started, so then I was sitting in the back because I had to run upstairs and grab a mic because I forgot I was preaching today because I thought some kids thought I looked stupid wearing a microphone before I was preaching. And saying all that, it's been a while since I've been up here, and then I began thinking, like, hey, some of you heard I'm preaching today, so some of you were like, hey, he's back. And then I began thinking, others of you were thinking, he's back. And then it got too hard of a laugh. So at the end of this, I'm just hoping we all say, that was okay. So we are continuing our series on kingdom living. And like a huge part of kingdom living, if you have seen our bulletins, it's a new logo, and we have, like, I guess our mantra, our mission statement, like what we're about at MGBC, and it's worship God and serve others. And a huge aspect of the kingdom of God is worshiping of God and serving others. But what happens when that becomes the issue? Like, what happens when the issue that you have is worshiping God and serving others? Like, what happens when that gets twisted? Like, what happens when you're trying to worship God and you're trying to serve others, and instead of that drawing you closer to God, you feel farther away from God? Like, what happens when you try to live out the principles of the kingdom of God and yet you still feel far from God? What's happening? So what we're going to do today, we're going to continue our series talking about kingdom living, and we're going to look at the positives of what the kingdom of God is about. We're going to look at it in a positive sense so you get a bigger view and a grander view of the kingdom of Jesus and your part in it. And then we're going to talk about some negative aspects on how that can get twisted in your heart. So let's go to the next slide. Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. This is how Jesus, he's continuing the Sermon on the Mount, and the Sermon on the Mount is Jesus sharing his heart, and more importantly, sharing what the kingdom is going to look like. And he says this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. So looking at this one more time, beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. So what do we take away from this verse? Here's the positive slide. Kingdom living leads to the best rewards. Kingdom living leads to the best rewards. That Jesus is saying, hey, if you live for me, there is a reward. So then I began thinking, well, we're kind of told this at times. As Christians, you only do good because you think God's going to give you something for it. While people who are not Christians can think this, okay, I just want to be good for the sake of being good. I don't need a reward for it. And I've been trying to wrestling through that, like, just thought process this week. I was talking to the other pastors about it, just trying to say, okay, so the good that we do, if we know we get a reward from God, is that tainted? And I've come to this conclusion, it's not. Because think about this, if you were created to do good, if you were created to be in a relationship with God, and God wants to give you a reward for what you do, it says more about God than anyone else. It says this, because you normally give rewards, you give gifts to those who you love. That if you have a coach, and he has an incentive for his team, and he says he'll give his team a reward, he wants the best for his team, and he's trying to motivate them. So you can look at it from this point of view. When God says, I'm going to give you a reward, it's God saying, hey, I'm rooting for you. I want you to be the best version of yourself. That rewards in themselves aren't bad. If the motivation of your heart, though, if it just stops at the reward, and not the one who gives the reward, then it becomes bad. But in reality, what a God, that God is literally saying, hey, I am rooting for you. I am cheering you on, that the God of heaven is not against you, but he wants the very best version of all of us. And to bring this on a simpler level, I won't lie. Sometimes I bribe kids with rewards, right? Not gonna lie. There's like no pure, but I just want them to listen, right? And I bribe them with rewards. And sometimes maybe you do that as parents or teachers or whatever, right? So we look at it from the negative. But the positive of giving rewards is that maybe you're trying to motivate someone to be the very best version of themselves. And you want to show your heart to them. When God wants to give you a reward, God is saying, look, I love you, and I want to motivate you to be the very best version of who you are in my kingdom. Which leads to this quote right here. God is always trying to give good things to us, but our hands are too full to receive them. And I love this quote by St. Augustine. And this is St. Augustine of Hippo. And Hippo was a northern city in Africa. And he just wrote a lot of good things that affect our thinking of God and Christianity and theology and doctrine today. But I just love that quote. And once again, let me say that one more time. God is always trying to give good things to us, but our hands are too full to receive them. Jesus says this, I want to give you a reward, right? He said that, you're going to see that throughout the passage we're going to go through, that he wants to give us rewards, but we miss out on the very best things that God has for us. And today we're going to look at that. Like, okay, so what is causing us to have our hands full? Like, what are we holding on to that's causing us not to receive the very best that Jesus wants to give us? So, as we take this tour of the kingdom, pause in your heart at times and look at your hands. Look at your hands and say, what's in my hands right now? What's in my heart? What's occupying self that God can't give me his absolute best? So let's go to the next slide. Matthew chapter 6, verses 2 through 4. And this is what it says. Thus, when you give to the needy, Sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Okay? So once again, you have Jesus. He's talking about the kingdom of God, and he's talking about as you're living your life, right? So what does the kingdom look like? Because he's telling you to live your life a certain way. It's a reflection of the kingdom. So what do we see about the kingdom of God in these verses? It would be this slide. Kingdom living is concerned with human dignity. Kingdom living is concerned with human dignity. Go back. Okay, so look at verse 3. But when you give to the needy, right, that the assumption that Jesus has is this. If you're going to be my follower, if you're going to be my disciple, if you're going to say you love me and follow me, Jesus is assuming that you're going to care about the less fortunate. That the assumption of Jesus our Lord is this, is that people who claim to be my followers, they have a heart for the less fortunate of society. And that's a really good thing right there, that as Christians, right, I'll take it a step further. As Christians, this whole idea of social justice is something we should be huge into. And I know for some of you, when I say social justice, it has a whole lot of things that come with it from a political side. I don't mean that. I simply mean this, that this whole idea of social justice is that we care about people, right? That we genuinely care about the dignity of every human being. And I want to show you a slide right now. This is the Red Cross. This is an ambulance. This is the YMCA. And we could say these are Christian organizations. The Red Cross. When natural disasters rock the world, the Red Cross goes there. Guess what? Christian origin, a Christian businessman started that, and he wanted to have an impact in this world. Okay, so this whole idea of the ambulance, if you see that symbol right there, that serpent and staff, and there's debate back and forth. Is that a Greek thing? But you could also make the argument that this was inspired by the Old Testament, where we're told that Moses lifted up the serpent and the staff, and it was like an iron serpent and staff, and people looked at that and they got healed. So there's Christian origins within this. And we can also look back at Western history. At one time, the Greeks, they led like this boom period in medical and hospitals, and they were big into that. But then a second surge of that came through Greek and Western history, and that was led by Christians who read the words of Jesus, and they were motivated by the heart of Jesus for people that were sick and hurting, and their Christian convictions led them to plant hospitals. The YMCA, Young Men Christian Association, they're trying to pull away from that now because it's just called the Y. But even that origin, the founder of the YMCA, he was looking at the young men of his day, and he was saying, either they're in taverns or they're in brothels, and that's bad for society. So what he did, he founded this organization where people could be trained physically, where they could be trained emotionally, where they could be trained spiritually, because he said, I want the best version of young men, because that's going to be the best version of society. All these things scream social justice. All these things scream human dignity. And once again, if you read this book, it's called The City of God and the City of Man, and it's by St. Augustine of Hippo, and he talks about social justice. And a lot of Christian research would say, hey, a lot of the Christian social justice movement, it traces all the way back to, I think, like the 4th century BC, for the 4th century AD with Augustine of Hippo. But even Augustine, he was inspired by the words of Jesus. So on a sub level, being a Christian calls you to be about social justice. And at the end of the day, when I mean social justice, regardless of a person's political agenda, regardless of a person's sexual orientation, regardless of any of it, is that you see all people as people, that all people have human dignity, and as a follower of Jesus, you want to defend that. And that's a good thing for us. Not that you have to agree with everyone, but at the end of the day, you view all people as people, and the kingdom of God is big in human dignity. And because I've mentioned Augustine of Hippo twice, and because Hippo was in Northern Africa, here's a picture of a hippo. Yeah, don't be deceived by that. That's a killer. Like, now this thing kills, like, more people than, like, any other animal in Africa. And I'm not going to lie, I was at the winter retreat, and is Seth here? He's not here. That's probably good. He doesn't need to hear this. But anyways, so Seth, he lives in Zambia, and I was talking to the middle school boys, and I said, hippo is the most dangerous animal in Africa. And he's like, no, it's not. It's a water buffalo. Well, Seth's not here today, so I'm going to say the hippo is the most dangerous animal in Africa, and it will kill you. And that's just like if you do missionary work or going to take a mission trip to Africa, if you see that animal, stay safe. Don't go near it. But it's funny because Augustine of Hippo, and I thought that would be a nice laugh break in my sermon. But anyways, moving on. Next slide. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. So when we look at that verse, like what do we get from that point? It's this slide. Kingdom living is concerned with authenticity. Kingdom living is concerned with authenticity. And that could be a really hard thing to do for us as Christians. Authenticity is probably a place we really struggle. That I want you to look at this, that they were praying, they were doing spiritual things, right? That when you do the spiritual walk with Christ, it's supposed to be authentic. But yet, that could be one of the hardest things for us to do. And if you think about this, this whole idea of serving others, right? Giving to the poor. Jesus says, hey, that can be twisted. You caring for other people, that can be twisted to something negative. Jesus says, hey, when you pray, guess what? Be careful. That could get twisted to something negative. So this whole idea of worship God and serve others can be twisted and turned to something negative, that the spiritual and the physical good things and the spiritual good things you do, if you're not careful, they get twisted. And if you look at both accounts, why were they both twisted? Hey, look, I'm giving to the poor. Look at me. Look at me. Hey, look, I'm praying. Look at me. Look at me. Right? You can laugh. That was meant to be laughed. Thank you. Because then I just feel awkward when, if no one laughs, it just looks awkward. But anyways, why is that important? It's the whole idea, I have to be accepted by others. It's not enough to be accepted by God. I have to be accepted by others. That I want you to think I'm a good person. That all of this leads to a place in this, that you don't feel accepted by God, And because you don't feel accepted by God, you look for acceptance in others. So the good that you do becomes twisted because ultimately it's meant to serve you and not serving others and not true worship of God. And if you looked up here earlier, think about this. My whole intro, right, I said this. You know, some of you are thinking, yay, I'm back. Others of you are thinking, he's back. Why am I so concerned about that? Why does that matter? Why does that matter to you, what people think so much? Or this morning, right, I'm up here smiling right now and everything. Brian can tell you, I was not smiling earlier this morning because our printer is possessed by the devil. That thing never works when I needed to work, right? It said there was a paper jam, and there was no paper jam. Like, we took it apart, we couldn't find it, and then I sent my document to Brian to be, like, printed, and his computer couldn't find it. So then I took the scrap sheet of paper, and I wrote these names down, and I went down to the Cedar High Study School class, and someone said, we're supposed to put our names on this? Right? But then I walked through the hallways, and I did this. Hey, good morning. Glad you're here. Completely unauthentic. Why? Because I'm so concerned that you would see me with an upset face, that you would think less of me. And if I'm concerned about that on such a small level, am I ever going to share the bigger issues of my heart with you? When we think about Christianity, right, and here's the thing. When I say you're going to be authentic, if you're upset, if you're sad, if you're frustrated, it's okay to be that way. But when you show that to someone and they try to speak into your life and you instantly shut them out, that's not good either. I think this whole idea of authenticity in Christianity is one of the hardest things any of us can do. Why? Because we're so concerned with looking good in front of one another. We're so concerned by jockeying to be accepted by each other that acceptance by God is not the top concern of our heart. And what does Jesus say? He says this. When you try to do kingdom living, and if I'm not the motivation of your heart, it just becomes exhausting. Think about this. There's a church version of you. There's a family version of you. There's a friend version of you. There's a coworker version of you. That you wear all these different hats, and eventually, it's just exhausting. Why? Because you're trying to be too many people. You're trying to be too many people in too many places. And what Jesus would tell you is this: be the one person I created you to be in all scenarios. Here's another side to this. If you don't feel your acceptance in Christ, if that's not the chief motivator of your heart to be accepted in Christ, but it's to be accepted by others, it creates pride. And pride does two things. It creates competition where competition isn't needed. Why? Because you look at this, well, I had this ministry thing over here, and you're having it the same night as me. Right? And more people went to their thing than my thing. So now you have competition in church where competition isn't needed. Or you do this. It creates bitterness because, hey, you know what I did here? You know what? I've been here for 50 years. Look what I've done. And no one's paying attention. Right? And maybe people do notice. But because it's not broadcasted up here, because there's not a spotlight up here saying it, it creates bitterness. Worship God and serve others. That is the heartbeat of Jesus. But when you're not accepted in Christ, that brings damnation upon your soul. Look at your hands. As we're journeying through the kingdom, where are your hands full that you cannot receive all that Jesus wants to give you? Where do you see pride propping up in your life? And more importantly, how does Jesus help us resolve this issue? How does Jesus help us deal with pride? How does he help us find acceptance in him? Next slide. Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. Look what Jesus says right here. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. So what does Jesus tell us right here? He says, hey, when you're doing spiritual things, and mostly prayer, when you're praying, right, find a place where it's just me and you. Find a place where you can have a private conversation with me. Why is that so important? Because if you're having this private conversation with Jesus, that's where authenticity can come out, right? So when you're finding this private room and you're having this private conversation with Jesus where no one is around, that Jesus say, hey, you are free to be you and you are free to tell me the real issues of your heart. And then you can find true acceptance in me. That the physical privacy and the physicalness of the room, right, it should be a reflection of our hearts. That before kingdom living ever becomes something of an outward pursuit, it has to be an inward pursuit of your heart. That for the kingdom to thrive outwardly, does the kingdom thrive inwardly in you? I love reading scripture, and one of the mysteries of scripture is this, that Jesus says the kingdom of God is within you. And if the kingdom of God, if it's really within you, is it thriving? What kingdom is taking place? A private prayer life is essential for kingdom living. Why? Because you can be authentically you in Christ, and then you are authentically accepted in Christ, which brings us to this. Next slide. Matthew chapter 6, verses 7 through 8, it says this. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do. And Gentiles means unbelievers, right? Don't throw up empty phrases like the unbelievers do, for they think they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So Jesus is saying this, that your prayer life isn't dictated by like all the phrases or all the things you know. It says, hey, keep it simple, right? Because guess what? My Father knows what you need before you ever ask him. So then why do I have to pray outwardly? Because I remember that was one of the best questions I've ever had. Okay, if God knows, if he can read our minds, why do I have to vocalize my prayers to God? And the whole idea of vocalizing your prayers to God, it's not that you have to remind God of things that he needs to know about your life. It's that you audibly hear it yourself. It's that you audibly confess your sins to God. It's that you audibly tell God the real condition of your heart. And what does that do to you? It puts humility there. We can inwardly say all of our flaws all day long. But when you audibly say, hey, this is my sin, when you audibly say, hey, this is where I see you working, hey, this is where I don't see you, all of that creates an atmosphere of humility and it strips you of pride. And here's a really cool thing. When Jesus gave this Sermon on the Mount, someone was in the crowd that day, someone by the name of Peter, he heard these words of Jesus. And let's go to the next slide. This is what Peter would write. So Second Peter is the last letter we have of Peter before he was put to death. And this is what Peter says. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. So what does Peter say? I'm sure he's remembering all the conversations of Jesus, and he's remembering the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, verse 3, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. So what was Peter convinced of about Jesus and prayer? This. Next slide. Kingdom living is placing confidence that the king will give us everything we need to follow him. Kingdom living is placing confidence that the king will give us everything we need to follow him. That Peter was so convinced by that, and going back to the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is saying, hey, guess what? My Father knows everything you need to serve him, and he will give you that. He won't give you everything you want, right? But everything you need to follow him is all there for you. So whatever stage of life you're in right now, you have everything you need for kingdom living. It's all there for us if we're willing to take that as face value and take that truth and walk with that. So how do we settle the issue of pride and acceptance? It starts with an internal prayer life, with a private prayer life to God. By praying to him privately, it gives us acceptance and it strips away pride. So what does prayer, what does it look like? Take your Bible, let's go to Matthew chapter 6. And look over at verse 9, and this is a different version. I have this is North American Standard Version. This is really just in my heart and everything, so it might look a little differently. But whatever version you have, I want you just to look at Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. And often we call this the Lord's Prayer. It should be called the Model Prayer because Jesus is teaching us how to pray right now. And this is what Jesus says prayer should look like in these categories. Pray that in this way, our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and power and the glory forever. Amen. You know what the theme of this prayer was? It was a Christ-centered prayer. It was a God-centered prayer. That all of this falls back on this. Are you placing all your confidence on God? That entire prayer is this reliance on God, I need you. God, provide for me. God, lead me. And then it hit on this. God, help me forgive others. Humility will create a heart where you can forgive others. Kingdom living, the essential part of it is this. Have a healthy prayer life. And that prayer life is healthy. It'll lead you in worshiping God and serving others. And you'll be thriving in kingdom living. So what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to ask the band come up as I pray. Dear Jesus, I want to say thank you for today. Thank you for showing us what your kingdom is all about and our place in it, that you desire worshipers. You desire people that genuinely care about others. You desire authenticity in our relationship with you. I pray as I'm talking about that in my own heart and in the hearts of people in this room, you would help us look at our hands, that what are we holding on to that's preventing us from receiving the good you want to give to us. I pray that issues of pride and issues of acceptance, that we would find all of those things in you, that we would drop our pride, we would drop our false confidence, and we would know that we are accepted fully by you. I just pray that that becomes our hearts, that our hands are open to what you would want to do for us. We give this prayer in your name. Amen.
Please stand. Let's worship together through singing.
as you go out this week and you're trying to do kingdom living, I'll just say, between living and kingdom living, just try living. Because if you're authentically living, it will be kingdom living. And where does all this find its place? Issues of pride and acceptance. It's all in the gospel. So the gospel of Jesus Christ is that you are fully accepted, that God is rooting for you. And I hope that truth stays in your heart. Because when you understand that you are truly accepted in Christ, issues of pride will fall away. They'll still be there. They'll creep up. But they'll fall away. And you'll authentically serve others without looking for a look at me. And you'll worship God. It'll be authentic in your heart. And that will be kingdom living. You're truly accepted and loved by Jesus in the gospel. Let's pray one more time. Dear Jesus, as we look into your kingdom, what a beautiful place that is. That human dignity is a real place. That people can be truly authentic. And that's what your kingdom is. I pray that we would want to see that right now, that we would be champions of human dignity, that we would treat people as people, that we would authentically worship you and fall in love with you. I pray that the gospel is a huge part of our lives, and we know that you're rooting for us and that you love us. We give this prayer in your son's name. Amen.